and we basically rewrote Article 8 on the crown of the helmet, and use the same language on lowering your head. For us, this is a pretty significant change. And this is not situational protection. So in the past, whether it's the college targeting rule or whether it's our defenseless player rule, which has a lot of similarities, it's situational protection. In this, we're basically getting to a technique that is just too dangerous for both the player doing it and the player that's getting hit, both. And what's really helped us a lot is in the last 2 to 3 years, we have really gotten better data and better information on injuries, better engineering work to understand collision angles, and better video. And I think what was apparent to the committee this year when we watched a lot of tape and met with the doctors is that we needed a change, and we needed a change in this area because we've got a good injury reduction strategy that starts with the simple use of helmets and using the proper helmets, has some things we want to do in preseason training camp, but the majority of it sits in this one technique because there's so many hits that we saw where a player lowered his head, delivered the hit, and either hit or hurt himself or hurt the person he was contacting. So we felt it was time for a change of this magnitude. We showed it to the coaches, we showed them the tape. We have showed it to the coaches' subcommittee, all of which endorsed it. We showed it to the NCAA, which I think we will impact over time, because I think our object would be to make our rules very similar to their rules from a terminology standpoint so that we can teach it all the way down. The crown of the helmet rule was really what was intended here, but got way too narrow and had too many requirements to it. This has very little requirement to it. This is simply if you lower your head to initiate contact and you make contact with an opponent, it's a foul. The reason the language is after disqualified is just a period is because we've got some things to work on. The coaches were pretty strong in the room today that in certain of these instances, there should be automatic ejection on the field. That's going to require us some work with them to understand language on what are the circumstances and what aren't. Would New York therefore automatically review? Probably, using what the college technique has been, we would probably go to that. But we need to kind of flesh that all the way out and understand it. And we didn't want to just go into a drafting mode today when we're going to pass a rule of this magnitude and not have the time to hear from the coaches and really hear from all the clubs on what they want and then again what we can do in New York and do effectively. So that's kind of the background of where we are and what we did. Any questions you've got, I'll answer them. And if not, I will turn it over to others too. Yes, come on.
Rich, was the impetus for this the Ryan Shazier play?
No, it's a good, the Ryan Shazier play is a play where he ducked his head and did before and was injured. I think the impetus was the research because the more we saw of the concussion plays and the more there was a common technique, it became more apparent that, listen, we need to get out of situationally saying, oh, if a player's targeted or if a defenseless player is in the air, we need to get to the technique that it can protect the person doing the hitting also, meaning could be Ryan Shazier, could be many others. I don't think that play was the impetus because I think that the research and the data was there before. I think it is an example though.
Rich, the committee has always been very much against bringing replay into judgment calls. On the other hand, you saw last year when you were instruct officials to eject for flagrant hits without the replay element, the officials seemed very reluctant to do that. So how do you sort of deal with those two issues?
Yeah, so we were in Indianapolis this year. For our committee, we really benefited by having the full-time officials there. I mean, it was very beneficial. I think in our catch, no catch language, as much as you may like it or argue with it, they played a big part in it, in understanding exactly what they were thinking as they're on the field and the mechanics. When it came to ejections, they impacted us. They said, hey, we're good. We see what we see. But when we know there's nothing behind us and we're gonna have to throw that player out and it's a situational protection where a guy's in the air and I've gotta determine, did he get hit here or did he get hit here? I'm gonna hesitate. And that, in our mind, has led to very few on-field ejections, mainly being for non-football acts. So I think that if you put replay behind them, then I think you do have the opportunity for them to be able to feel more comfortable in ejecting. But in this rule, we just need to do a little work to understand exactly how the mechanisms would work. But I think we do feel comfortable, and I think it was said in there today, that if there's an ejection, then replay probably would play a part.
So that's enough for the committee to get over sort of replay coming into judgment calls?
No, we're not over it, but it is enough to say that the result is such that maybe that result needs to be reviewed. I can't argue with you on that.
Rich? On first look, this would appear to help the tackler more than the person being tackled as far as a Shazier-type incident. But is it, are you worried it's too broad? In other words, if diving, this almost seems to eliminate a diving tackle, because if you graze an ankle of a runner going by or his non-carrying arm, that would qualify under this rule, wouldn't it?
No, it good point. If you are initiating contact, right, with the crown of your helmet, and you have, not with your helmet, I should say, and you have gone low and you hit them, yes. If you graze them, make contact, I don't think that's going to be the problem, John. I think, listen, we need to write a broad rule because we need to make change. And we need, what's happened to us is we looked at our numbers in the last 3 years, our helmet-to-helmet contact has gone up a lot. And it just seems like players at every level are getting more comfortable playing with their helmets as a weapon as opposed to a protective device. The helmet was designed to be a protective device, and therefore, we need a rule that's broad that puts that in context, and that's what we think this does.
Between this and the catch rule modification, does this mark a move to maybe more broader language than the rule book in general?
Yes, because this has no situational limit. There's no limit. We saw plays where there was a wide nine, you know, technique of a defensive end coming in, and he absolutely lowered his head and hit the offensive tackle, right? You wouldn't think of a lowering the or crown of the helmet or a lowering the head in offensive defensive line play. We saw it, we see it. And if that's seen, that's a foul. We don't think it should be situational. We need to get to the behavior, and that the behavior is lowering the helmet, using the helmet, and being very comfortable using the helmet as a weapon. It's not what it's designed for, and that's not what the rule book should say.
Yeah, Richard, does the data also show that not just the helmet-to-helmet has increased, but that injuries resulting from the helmet-to-helmet have increased, or concussions have increased, or anything that connects those things?
Well, our concussion numbers were up this year.
From helmet-to-helmet?
Yes, but there's more helmet-to-helmet hits. Okay. So I think the answer of both those would be yes, and I'll let them give you know, numbers, but yes. And when you look at where we were, you know, 5 years ago, it really says to you that at all levels, people are getting more comfortable again using that helmet, and that is not where this game should be.
And not related, but can this also refer to or apply to ball carriers, not just the tackles?
Yes, absolutely. As you know, the crown of the helmet could apply to ball carriers. Yeah. It does, now remember, if a player is in a defensive posture and is bent or what, they're not initiating contact with their helmet. But if a player is going to go through and lead with his head and change his body angle, sure.
Okay.
Jeff?
Rich, could you go over what's been withdrawn and also what's been voted down?
You're always like the secretary.
Thank you.
So let me think about this. The